All right. Good morning, church. As Andrew mentioned, my name is Caleb Luke. I've been a part of Harvest City for almost as long as I can remember. I also spent all of my pre-K to grade 12 schooling at the school here. So this place is basically my second home. I'm also part of a few worship teams here on Sunday. You may recognize me better with a guitar on me, but now I'm here. My dad, Corey Luke, you may also know as one of the elders in the church. He's also that crazy guy that runs around on stage a lot. They decided to go on a cruise while I was doing my message, so they're watching online, so hi, Mom and Dad. There we go. That's their little shout-out. I also help lead a life group with my wife and a few other young adults over here. It's been an amazing experience. For those who don't know me, that's just a little spark notes on myself. I actually have spoken here on stage before. This was around the church's 50-year anniversary last year. Three of us young adults, again, got to each share for 10 minutes. And so when Joel asked me to preach a full message today, I had two different thoughts. The first being, I guess I didn't do as bad as I thought last time. And the second one being, I don't think I've talked about anything for 35 minutes straight. So this is going to be a new experience for me. I thank you in advance for your patience and your grace. On the bright side, camera crew, you're going to get probably the easiest day of your life. I don't know how far I'm going to be moving from my notes today. I'll move on. it really is an honor to be sharing my life verse today. And it's been so encouraging hearing everybody else share on their life verses and their messages throughout the summer. It's just amazing how God's been using each person's stories to encourage and challenge our own lives. And I know that's been the case for myself. And when preparing for my message, I went through quite a few different verses, each that have had their own significance in my life and in my heart. I've always loved Joshua 1:9. It's a very famous verse. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Do not be discouraged, for the Lord God is with you wherever you go. So I know he's here with me today. I've also loved Isaiah 40 verse 8, the grass withers, the flowers fade, but the word of our God lasts forever. Those are very powerful verses, each that I could give their own message on, but for the verses that I've held on to for the majority of my life, there has been one that has always stuck out to me above the rest, and so much so that it's actually been the home screen on my phone for the last 5 or 6 years now. And my home screen has the following message on it. It says, "Let tomorrow worry about itself." This is a simple yet a powerful reminder, and it's one that I constantly have to remind myself every single day, multiple times a day. And this line is taken from Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. It can be found in Matthew 6, verses 25 through 34. And I'm going to read that with you together. So it says, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or stow away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, 'What shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear?' For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." So I am no stranger to worrying. In fact, it worries me how much I've worried in my life, especially when writing this message. So I'm preaching to myself today. But from wanting to succeed in school and career, to how much money I have, to how people perceive me, to what the future will hold, I don't want to brag, but you may call me a professional worrier. My wife can probably tell you the same thing. But while preparing for this message, I was initially shocked to find how many different teachings there were on the subject of worry. But the more I thought of it, the more it began to make sense. I know that there's things in our life that, in each of our lives, that can cause worry. And it made me realize I may not be the only professional worrier sitting here today. And maybe Jesus knew this. So whether it be our jobs, our families, relationships, school, our appearance towards others, the state of our world right now, there's an infinite number of things. Some of you may be getting worried by me listing them off, so I'll move on. But my hope for this message today is that we're able to unmask worry for what it really is and look at what Jesus tells us about worry through our passage in Matthew 6 so that we have the tools to overcome it before it overwhelms us. Before we begin, I'm just going to pray with you all. So, Lord, we just thank you for another day to praise you. We thank you for your word that is a light unto our feet. I pray that you would just take the lead this morning, that you would be the one that shines through today, that anything not of you would be thrown away. I pray that you would just give us hearts that are open to receive your word and your healing and your blessing today. And we praise you and thank you for all you're doing in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. So, before jumping into the ways that we can overcome worry, I think it's important to understand what it is and why it's so destructive. So what is worry? I don't think it would be right to give a message on a topic and not give you the Webster's Dictionary definition, so I'm going to give it to you. Here it is. Worry is described as mental distress or agitation resulting from concern, usually for something impending or anticipated. It's a bit of a mouthful. It's a good one. But when reading it over a few times, I was able to boil this down to the fear of the unknown. It's allowing ourselves to get caught up in the what-ifs of life. What if I do awful on this job interview? What if myself or a family member gets sick? What if I fail that test? What if that COVID thing comes back? What if I mess up that line in the song or play the wrong chord? That was mine. I added that in there. And who can forget the scariest of them all? What if I sleep through my alarm? The list could go on and on. And I apologize for making you worry again. I promise I'm done. I know some of those examples are more serious than others, but that's the danger of worry. It can start as one small thing and quickly multiply into a million big ones. It's a poison that can consume our thoughts and our lives for as long as we allow it to, and it can ultimately kill our walk with the Lord. Jesus actually warns us of this in Mark 4 and the parable of the sower. He says in verses 18 and 19, "Still others, like seeds sown among the thorns, hear the word, but the worries of life, the deceitfulness of wealth, and the desires for other things come in and choke the word, making it unfruitful." Worry is a timeless issue. It is just as, if not more, prevalent in our world today than it was when Jesus gave this sermon. And it's also just as destructive. And why do we do it? According to a few articles, so three of the most common reasons for why we worry are as follows. It can be our body's alarm to alert us of potential danger. It can be a fear of losing control. It can even be from caring too much about something. But as believers, this reason goes even further, and it boils down to something much more serious. As a professional worrier myself, it was not a fun one to discover, so I'm going to share it with you. Here it is. Worry stems from a lack of trust in God to provide. There's a quote from Pastor Greg Rochelle that puts it another way. He says that where you worry the most is where you trust God the least. Ouch. But it's human nature to want control over our lives. Where there's no control, there's anxiety, there's confusion, there's fear. But the simple truth is that there are things in our life we will never be able to have control over. And that is where our trust in God is put to the test. Jesus tells us in verse 34, each day has enough trouble of its own. As mentioned earlier, worry stems from a fear of the unknown. It forces us to look too far ahead, and it steals our appreciation for today. We become critical or skeptical, and it's exactly where the enemy wants us to be. It blocks out all the amazing things that God is doing in the present. But here's the good news. We have the tools to overcome worry. This doesn't mean that net worry will never come against us again, but when it does, we are equipped and prepared with the tools needed to put it in its place. And so the final and most important question remains, what do we do about worry? To answer that question, I'm going to present three different things that we see from our passage in Matthew 6 that we read earlier. Jesus, in fact, gives us very practical and useful tools for coming against the worries of life. And they are as follows. Number one, we need to seek first the kingdom. Number two, we need to seek out a heavenly perspective. And number three, we need to seek out the Sabbath. So number one, Jesus tells us to seek first the kingdom. So in Matthew 6, verses 31 and 32 says, "So do not worry, saying, 'What shall we eat? What shall we drink? Or what shall we wear?' For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." There's a story I heard about a man, and he was talking to his friend one day, and this man was going through probably the most difficult time in his life. He had lost his job. He had thousands of dollars in debt. He was having marital issues. His car broke down. The list could go on. But his friend asked him, he said, "You're going through all this stuff in your life, but how is it that you don't seem to be worried?" And the man replied, "It's really easy, actually. I hired a guy to do all my worrying for me. So anytime I have something to worry about, I just give it to him to handle." His friend asked him, he's like, "That sounds amazing. How much do you pay this guy?" To which the man replied, "I pay him $50,000 a year." His friend was shocked. "How are you going to afford that?" And the man replied, "I have no clue. That's for the other guy to worry about." I really love this story, and while of course it's not a true one, I think it still holds a really powerful message. This man's first reaction to any form of worry, it was peace, it was joy, it was rest, it was knowing that he had someone to go to give his worries to. And while we can't pay people to take our worries away, like the man in the story, we have access to something and someone much greater. We have a God that loves us so much that he would freely take our worries and carry us through them. 1 Peter 5, verse 7, it tells us to cast all your anxiety, cast all your worries upon him because he cares for you. The challenge from this verse remains, when worry comes, what do we seek first? Is it control? Is it spending hours a day doing everything you can to find a solution, even if you know you never find one? Is it endlessly scrolling through Netflix or refreshing your social media feed so that you don't need to address the things for a little while longer? I used to just pray for the rapture, I'll be honest. maybe it's all of the above. But Jesus asked the question, can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? Of course, this answer is no. And in fact, we lose many hours of our lives worrying. But it's our response to worry that we need to examine and be aware of as well. Our first response to worry will either set us on the path to destruction or it will set us on the path to freedom. And that freedom only comes by seeking God first. Seeking, it means to look for, to go after, to search for with the intention of finding. And the good news is God wants us to find him. That comes from spending time with our Father in prayer. It comes through his word, through our worship, through our repentance, through our thanksgiving. When we put these things into practice, we have the promise that when we seek him, we will find him. That when we knock, the door will be answered. this practice of seeking first the kingdom, it requires sacrifice. It requires breaking old habits and forming new ones, and the enemy will do everything he can to stop that because he knows the power of our God. But when we are able to make him our first choice, it makes our second strategy for overcoming worry a whole lot easier, which is that when worry comes, we need to seek out a heavenly perspective. So going back again to the beginning of our passage from Matthew 6, I'm going to read verses 25 and 26 again. It says, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or stow away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they?" I find this passage really fascinating, specifically in the way that Jesus uses the birds, how they live their lives as an illustration for how we ought to live our own. Because the birds, they seem to react a lot differently to the worries that they face in life. When we worry, we pace around, we shut down, we complain, we run to our addictions, pray for the rapture, we're anxious, the list could go on. And it's important to understand that the people that Jesus was speaking to in this passage, he talks about storing up possessions. And these people he was addressing, they were not 21st century modern individuals. They didn't have retirement plans or savings accounts. Their wealth was measured by the things that they had. They didn't have things to fall back on if things went south. So instead, they would store up more and more possessions that they would be able to sell in fear of not being able to provide for themselves or their families. And yet, even though we live in the 21st century, we still fall into the same trap. We try to save ourselves from having to worry by storing up possessions, by working endlessly for higher positions that will give us more security. And Jesus knew this about humanity and human nature. He knew that this issue would not go away, and yet he simply tells us to examine what a bird does when it's hungry. A bird doesn't sit up in its nest, pacing around, rubbing its wings together, wondering if it had slept in too long or if it had saved up enough worms in case there was a shortage that year. It also doesn't go spending all of its time building more nests, storing up more than what it needs, just in case something bad happens to it. The bird doesn't do that. Instead, if it needs food, it gets up and it goes to look for it, trusting that God is going to provide for it. And Jesus gives us a new perspective in this way. He says that if he even provides for the smallest creatures, that if they can walk into each day trusting that they are going to be fed, then we need to do the same. Worries do not solve themselves by sitting around all day worrying about them. But on the other side of the coin, they will also not solve themselves by getting caught up in trying to prevent every possible thing that could go wrong. That will just cause new worry. It is instead about stepping into the day, saying, no matter what lies ahead of me, no matter what comes to steal my joy, I trust that God is my provider. To put this a little more into perspective, I would like to offer you three different outcomes for the worries that we face. I'm a math teacher. I love numbers and probabilities, so this was it caught my attention quite a bit more than a lot of things. So, there's three outcomes when we worry about something. Number one is that the thing we worry about doesn't even happen. In fact, there was a study that was conducted in 2017 by Cornell University. And they asked individuals to write down their greatest worries, their greatest fears, and to document those things over the next 30 days to see how many of those things actually happen. And what they found was fascinating. They found that over 85% of the time, and some people even said it was over 90%, but at least 85% of the time, those things that those individuals wrote down never occurred in the slightest way. In fact, the worst thing that came out of that situation is that they wasted time worrying about it. So that's number one. Most likely outcome of worry, the thing we worry about doesn't happen at all. But I can still sense my other fellow professional worriers saying, well, 85% is a lot, but what about the 15%? Right. Well, that leads us to outcome number two, which is that the thing we worry about, it happens, but it's not as bad as we thought. So that same study, it looked at the remaining individuals. And of that 15%, they found that 79%, or 12% of the entire population, either discovered that they could handle the situation better than they thought, or that the difficulty actually resulted in a positive result. Maybe some of them were worried about an interview, and they didn't do as well as they thought, or they missed a few points, but they still got the job, they learned some valuable skills from it. Or maybe they had an important presentation, and they messed up. People laughed for a few seconds, but now people actually like them more, because they saw that you're human and don't have to be so serious all the time. So combined with outcomes number one and two, they found that of every individual they studied, 97% of them were either never affected or came out of it unscathed. That leaves just 3%. Outcome number three, maybe you can guess this one. That's where the thing you worried about happened. It was as bad as you thought. Maybe it was worse than you thought, and God will carry you through it. And these are the times where you're able to discover the true peace and presence of God like you've never felt it before. These are the times when your faith is truly put to the test. It's the time we learn which soil we are planted in. Are we going to be choked out by the situations and worries, or are we going to be rooted in God's promises? Are we going to turn away and try to fix things on our own, or are we going to turn towards God and let Him bring comfort, let Him strengthen us, let Him bring healing and hope? Romans 5, verse 3 to 5, it tells us, not only so, but we also glory or celebrate in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. Church, as believers, it should not matter if we are the 85%, the 12%, or the 3%, because we can be 100% certain that we have a God who is for us and not against us, who sees our worries, who sees our hurts and our pains, and that no matter what, He is building character through it. He is building a deeper trust in Him. To clarify, I'm not saying that your problem with finances is small, or the worry about your marriage or your kids or your exam is insignificant. I'm not saying that worry will never come against us and we will never make the mistake of letting it in. But what I am saying is that when we have Jesus in our lives, we can look at our worries and say, my God is bigger. Amen. So here is the heavenly perspective that Jesus provides us. It's not about telling God how big our worries are. It's about telling our worries how big our God is. And that is the perspective that changes the way we enter into each day. The final way I would like to cover in how we can overcome worry is that we need to seek out the Sabbath. So while we have already pointed to the fact that when worry comes, seeking God should be our first response, it's also crucial that those are not the only times in our lives where we are seeking Him. It's also important to set aside time solely for the renewal and time with the Lord. Corrie ten Boom has a famous quote about worry, and I learned this week that it's actually a she. My bad. I had he written in my notes, but you learn something new every day. They're very wise, nonetheless. But she says, worrying is carrying tomorrow's load with today's strength. It is carrying 2 days at once. It is moving into tomorrow ahead of time. Worry doesn't simply empty tomorrow of its sorrow. It empties today of its strength. This is a powerful quote. It points to worry as the killer of Sabbath and rest. If we're constantly carrying the weight of tomorrow, we will never be able to slow down. Sabbath is critical because it breaks this cycle. Where worry, it takes our strength, Sabbath helps us renew it. But of course, the idea of Sabbath and rest, taking time just for our time with the Lord, it's become somewhat of a novel idea, almost a myth in our society. But I've actually been reading one of the most amazing and challenging books ever written, and it's by the author John Mark Comer. It's titled The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry. I highly recommend it. It's been a huge inspiration for myself in the last few months, even this last year, and I know a lot of the young adults have also read it, and it's impacted them as well. But in this book, he talks about this hurry culture that we have adopted in our society. It's this constant feeling like we aren't doing enough, that our value, our worth is based on the amount of stuff we have or the things that we do. And so we've adopted this lifestyle of fast-paced, of hurried, of constantly distracted. He uncovers just how destructive this has been on our relationships, on our health, and our walk with God especially. However, he uses the Gospels to examine the life of Jesus, and he notices how radically opposite it was to how we live today. Comer points out that true rest involves not just getting away from the external noises of the world, it also involves turning off the internal noises of worry that we face, something that, of course, is a lot harder to do. But knowing the life of Jesus, he provides us the tools needed to find rest. So, Comer, he points to a few elements that he calls the antidotes to a hurry and a worried-filled life, and will ultimately help us find rest in this world that demands so much of us. The first of these being simplicity. So this is getting rid of the desire to constantly need more. More stuff, more status, more things to do. It's setting our priorities straight and removing the rest. It's a lifestyle that focuses solely on what adds true value to our lives and throwing out everything that's unnecessary. The second practice he points to is silence. This is intentionally creating moments of quiet and stillness in our lives, free from the constant noise and distractions that surround us. It is unplugging from the overwhelming amount of information and digital distraction that we are presented with on a daily basis. It's giving ourselves the opportunity to listen, to breathe, and to reflect deeply with ourselves and with God. The third practice he talks about is solitude. This is withdrawing from the company of others and spending time alone. He points out that solitude is not to be mixed up with isolation or loneliness. Those are the things that the enemy tries to convince us of in those times. But for those who know Superman from the comics or the movies, you may also know of the Fortress of Solitude. I looked this up online, and one of the first things it will tell you is that the Fortress of Solitude, and I quote, is the place where Superman first learned about his true identity, his heritage, and his purpose on Earth. For us as believers, it's no different. Sabbath is the place where we can go to renew our strength, to find our identity, to seek the face of our Creator. It is our place of Sabbath. There is another quote from Corrie Ten Boom that I think sums this up really well. She says, "Look around and be distressed. Look inside and be depressed. But look at Jesus and be at rest." Amen. And Jesus was the perfect model for rest. We see from his life just how seriously he was about the Sabbath. In fact, if you explore the Gospels, you'll actually see that the busier Jesus got in his ministry, the more we find him withdraw to be with his father, away from the noise and the worries of the crowds that he was inevitably faced with. He did this to renew his strength. He knew that we needed it. The Bible is clear that Sabbath should not be an option. In fact, it's actually commanded of us. Exodus 20, verse 8 tells us to remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. This wasn't a command created as a means to keep us down or hold us back. It's actually quite the opposite. Sabbath is a gift given to us by God, who knew that there would always be worries, that tomorrow would always be uncertain. But even through that, we have the choice to put them aside and put rest in its place. As Jesus says at the end of Matthew 6, and the reminder I have on my phone each and every day, let tomorrow worry about itself. Seek out the Sabbath. So in summary, what we see from the words of Jesus in Matthew 6 and the life that we see him live through the Gospels is this. In this world, there will be worries of all kinds. But when we seek the kingdom first, we open our eyes to see with a new perspective. This new perspective brings us to the realization that we need Sabbath, we need rest, and that ultimately, when we're able to find rest, worry doesn't have any other place to go than at the feet of Jesus, who we can trust is going to carry us through it. That's all I have. I'm going to close in prayer, and then I'll dismiss. So, Lord, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you that you are our provider, that you are the one that we can go to for all our problems in life. God, we know that there are worries that we will face in life, but we pray that we would walk in today trusting that you are our provider, that you are our strength. Lord, I pray that you would just go with each person in this room today. Let these words become our actions. We thank you and praise you once again for all you're doing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hey everyone, I just want to thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. We hope you enjoyed it and found something that spoke to you or blessed you in some way. That really is the heart of Harvest City Church, that you'd take what you've heard, learned, or experienced here, and then go out and share that good news with others. So go ahead and post this video to your page, start conversations, and who knows the lives that God could transform through it. If we can support you in some way in this season, please let us know. Maybe you've decided to dedicate your life fully to Jesus. We want to hear about it and celebrate with you and help you in those first steps. Connecting in to share the joys and the struggles of life is why we're here. Finding community is super important too, so if you're wondering about any of our programs for kids, youth, or adults, just reach out to us by phone or at the link below and we'll be in touch. To all of those who are partnering financially with us, thank you for your investment into the kingdom of God. It allows us to do what he's calling us to and reach even more people. For more info on that, go over to harvestconnect.ca/give. If you haven't already, be sure to check out our live stream chat area at harvestconnect.ca/live. It's a great place for interaction, commenting, prayer with our online hosts, and more. Don't forget to like and subscribe to our social pages and all that good stuff too. Take care, keep living your call, and we'll see you again real soon.